Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Be seated. And welcome to Duck Church. We're glad that you're with us today as we worship the Lord together in the house of God. We're going to get to our worship time shortly, but as we begin, I want us to think on the following scripture from Psalm 100, verses 4 and 5. It says this: Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his court with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. As we gather together and get things started this morning, I'd like for you to find your connection card in your bulletin. It looks just like this one. And if you would take a moment to fill that out, it would really help us to get to know you a little better, how we might better serve you and pray for you or pray with you. If you're with us for the first time, we're especially glad that you've joined us. And if you would be so kind as to check the box on the left-hand side that says first-time guest, that would really be helpful. Now, over on the back side, there are some next steps. And as you no doubt know from getting here this morning, there are a lot of people on the Outer Banks this weekend. A lot of people coming to enjoy. And let me invite you to pray for their safe travel and to pray that they would have a wonderful time of rest and relaxation in this beautiful spot that we get to enjoy year-round. Today we're going to be looking at a passage from John's Gospel, chapter 8, verses 34 through 36, and the message is freedom. Dwight L. Moody, the dynamic evangelist from the mid to late 1800s, once said, "If you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you are free." So let's celebrate the freedom we have in Jesus Christ as we stand now and join together in our call to worship, which is printed in your bulletin. Let's stand together. The Lord be with you. Blessed be the nation whose God is the Lord. The Lord God has promised to be with and watch over all those who trust and obey him. We gather to thank him for all his mercies, to remember those who have given themselves for the sake of justice and truth, and to pray for his blessings to be upon us and those who rule over us. If you'll find your hymnal in the rack ahead of you and turn to page 697, we'll join together in singing our first hymn, America.
Thank you.
thank you, and you may be seated. All have sinned and fallen short of God's glory, but God's mercy and grace never fall short. With confidence in God's blessing and his forgiveness, let us confess our sin before him. Would you join me in praying the prayer you'll find printed in your bulletin? As a community of believers, Holy One, we open ourselves to your restorative presence. We are surrounded by beauty, yet we often fail to wonder. We are symbols of hope, yet often succumb to despair. We are blessed beyond measure, yet we often allow greed to shape our generosity. We are uncommonly free, yet we often bind ourselves to yesterday's failures. We are gifted and graced as a people of faith, yet we often fail to let our light shine. We are loved beyond measure, yet we often fail to pass on your love unconditionally. In these moments of shared silence, encourage us to lay down our burdens, release our fears, forgive our failures, reclaim our hopes, and align ourselves with your deep wisdom. Amen. We are the light of the world by the power of God's grace. Our freedom is a gift. Receive it fully. Our purpose is justice. Do it rightly. Our hope is peace. Pursue it faithfully. Our calling is life. Live it well. God is faithful in all things, and so it is. Friends, you may be seated. We've got you up and down a lot today, don't we? We call this Christian calisthenics. Well, it is at this portion of our service that we devoted to the ministry of prayer. And as we go before the Lord to pray this morning, we are mindful of those that are constantly on our hearts and minds, those that perhaps are on our own individual prayer lists at home. And we want to lift those before the Lord together today. So let's remember Amy and Jason. I think Amy is down to her last chemo treatment. She has a surgery date for her breast cancer on the 27th at the end of this month. And then she'll be having some radiation as a follow-up to that. Are there others that we should lift together in prayer this morning? Yes.
Brad,
thank you. Beverly and Martha, thank you. John?
Jan and Heather and Janet.
Jan and Heather and Janet. Yes,
Brad. And I would like to give a praise report. I would like to thank God and all of you all who have been praying for my son. You all, I want to give you an update because I've been lifting up his name, Alex, for years in this church. And I thank you all for praying faithfully. My son has been struggling with addiction since he was 13, and he is 27 now. He just spent the week with us, he and his little family, and he's been doing well for about a full while now. But he just spent a week with us, and it was the first, I guess you could call it, normal week that we've had with him in years and years, and I am so grateful. And it's been a long time coming, and it's a chronic addiction, as you know, is a chronic condition, so please keep praying for him. But it's definitely an answer to prayer, and I want to thank God, I want to thank you all. And just a lesson I guess learned is just wait on God, because you'll get there. He knows what's going to happen.
Yes. Any others? Yes.
I pray for those that are in harm's way because of war, for those that are emotionally or physically in peril.
Yes, those in harm's way because of war, and especially we think about the folks in Ukraine at this time, but that's not the only place in the world. Thank you for that reminder. Yes.
Brad Russell and family.
Okay, thank you. Any others? Yes. Okay, prayers for Graham. Thank you. Any others? All right. Well, let's go before the Lord as we pray together. God, as we pause this weekend to think about freedom, to recognize the freedoms that are so easy for us to take for granted, we also are reminded that we don't experience freedom until we walk in it. And there are a lot of ways that we enjoy and experience freedom in this nation in which we live, but there are also a lot of ways in which we're not walking in the freedom that is offered to us. As we approach your word in just a little bit, I pray that your Holy Spirit would inspire us to hear, to receive, and that we might be granted the courage to walk in the freedom whereby Christ has set us free. Today, as we come together bearing names of loved ones, those that are struggling, those who we can celebrate because they're showing progress because of your faithfulness. We bring these persons called aloud and those lifted in silence before you this day and pray that they too might experience the freedom that they seek. That those that are sick might experience healing. That those that are troubled might find in you the help they need. For those, Lord, that are gathered in this place today that we have not called aloud, maybe for ourselves, maybe for our spouse, our family, a loved one, we pray that in you we might find fullness of life, spiritual, physical, relational, emotional, financial, and that we might walk in obedience before you. Lord, usher us into your presence and help us to know that if God is for us, who can be against us? We take comfort in your word and in your presence, and we lift all of these prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who himself taught us to pray by praying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Friends, let's stand once more as we join together in singing "America the Beautiful." It's found on page 696.
Thank you.
Friends, as you put your hymnal away, why don't you turn to greet someone that you don't know, welcome them to Duck Church, and pass the peace of Christ. Friends, the Apostles' Creed is found printed in your bulletin for your convenience. Let's lift our voices together as we proclaim what it is we believe as followers of Jesus Christ. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please take your seat. And turn with me to John chapter 8. If you have your Bible, that's great. If you don't, no worries. We've got an outline in your bulletin that has the scripture for you to follow along as I read it to you. But before I read it, let me just say that I believe with all my heart that this is God's word to humanity. It is primarily God's word of love to humanity. And today we're going to read but three verses and see if we can apply it to our life to discover the freedom that God has for us. So listen for the word of God. Jesus replied, "I tell you the truth, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now, a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." Let us pray. O Lord, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Give us grace to receive your truth in faith and love, and strength to follow on the path you set before us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, tomorrow is the 4th of July, and we will celebrate our nation's 246th birthday. A nation based on the ideals of liberty, responsibility, godliness, and freedom to become what God intended us to become was a new and revolutionary idea. The celebration of our nation's birthday is really a celebration of freedom. We celebrate the precious gift of freedom that we have because the price was paid by others. We remember, like so many at this time of the year, remember that freedom isn't free. Freedom is very expensive. It has cost some people everything, including their lives. Freedom isn't free, but it is infinitely valuable. The ideal of freedom is an ideal that our founding forefathers and foremothers believed valuable enough to risk everything on. They risked their fortunes, their families, their reputations, and their honor. They risked their very lives, and many of them paid for our freedom with their own blood and with the blood of their children. Today, as we worship in security and comfort, we do so because thousands have given their lives and shed their blood on foreign soil. They died in forsaken places with names not remembered, so that we could experience the joy and the responsibility of freedom. In a letter to William Smith dated November the 17th, 1787, Thomas Jefferson wrote, "The tree of liberty must be refreshed from time to time with the blood of patriots and tyrants. The price of freedom is always paid in blood." The blood spilled on battlefields called Concord and Charleston and Yorktown was not the first time that blood was spilled for freedom. 2,000 years ago, another's blood spilled upon the ground so that we could all experience freedom. Jesus came in order to bring us freedom from a host of human maladies. As Christians, we believe that Jesus is the Son of God, not just a great prophet, not just a great teacher, but the Son of God. And in John 8, 34 through 36, as we read, Jesus replied, "I tell you the truth, everyone who sins," and that's all of us, "everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son," capital S, "if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." Later, the Apostle Paul wrote these words regarding the work of Jesus setting us free. He said, "Through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death." Notice that's past tense. Not will set you free, not might, but has. The Spirit of life in Christ, like a strong wind, has magnificently cleared the air, freeing you from a fated lifetime of brutal tyranny at the hands of sin and death. Tomorrow we celebrate an independence as a nation that is temporary. A day may very well come when we no longer enjoy the freedoms we have. Nevertheless, we celebrate independence. But shouldn't we celebrate our independence from the tyranny of and bondage of guilt, sin, fear, and death, and independence won over 2,000 years ago? Shouldn't we celebrate and discover the depths of an independence that will last for all eternity? If you want to be truly free, free from all that has tied your life down and buried you under a mountainous weight of fear and guilt, then this message is for you. Today we'll explore just three of the ways that Jesus sets us free if we will only have faith to trust in Him. And the first freedom that we find through Jesus is freedom from guilt. Our past can't haunt us. Have you been dragging your past around? You know what I mean. You've done things in the past that have hurt others, or you yourself have been hurt. You failed miserably in the past. You failed at marriage. You failed at parenting. You failed financially because of your own irresponsibility. You failed at religion. It's just too hard to keep all those rules. You failed and failed and failed. And the guilt of your failures and poor decisions is dragging around behind you, keeping you from soaring. Your past sins are like an anchor that keep you earthbound when your heart longs to be more. Well, how would you like to be free from that guilt? The key word here is forgiven. Now, in a single victorious stroke of life, sin, guilt, death, all three are gone, the gift of our Master Jesus Christ. Ephesians 1:7 says, "He is so rich in kindness that he purchased our freedom through the blood of his Son, and our sins are forgiven." Because of the work that Jesus did in winning your freedom, you don't have to carry your guilt around with you. You can release it and be free. In the movie The Mission, the story is told of Captain Rodrigo Mendoza. Mendoza was a slave trader in the mid-1700s, and Mendoza and his men would enter the jungles of Brazil and Ecuador to raid the Indian villages and take prisoners to sell as slaves. He even went so far as to raid the Catholic missions to take prisoners from the Indians that were there. In a duel over a woman, Captain Mendoza kills his own brother and falls into a remorse-filled depression, believing that God cannot forgive him. However, one of the priests from the mission, San Carlos, offers Mendoza an opportunity to seek penance. And just as Rodrigo Mendoza found forgiveness in the hands of those that he had violated, so we find forgiveness in the nail-scarred hands of the one whom we have violated and betrayed. Just as the people he had sinned against cut away his guilt from him and set him free with forgiveness, so the God we have sinned against cuts away our guilt and sets us free with the forgiveness that he offers in his Son, Jesus Christ. Friends, wouldn't it be nice to know that you don't have to drag your past around with you? Wouldn't forgiveness be a breath of fresh air? You can have that forgiveness because Jesus offers it to us. When we come to Jesus and let him set us free, we are free from guilt. But there's another freedom that Jesus offers to us, and that's freedom from consequence. Now, we all know that when the law is broken, there are consequences, and sometimes we can escape the legal consequences of our misdeeds, but there are still consequences. The guilt we just talked about is the consequence of sin. And there are others as well, but there is one consequence that no matter how hard our heart or how seared our conscience, we must all face. The ultimate consequence for sin is that of death. And not just a physical death, but eternal spiritual death. The Bible teaches that we will all face judgment. In fact, Hebrews 9:27 says, "Everyone has to die once, then face the consequences." That verse tells us that there are consequences for our sin. And what is that consequence? Well, Romans 6:23 states it clearly. For the wages of sin is what? Death. There is a severe consequence. According to Scripture, the ultimate consequence for our sin is one that we cannot pay. But the good news is that we don't have to. The penalty for our sin has already been paid. Our account has been credited, and we are, as we saw just a moment ago, no longer guilty. The key word here is vicarious. Now, vicarious is a big and fancy word that means done by one person substituting for another. Christ has dealt with the consequences for our sin. It's not that the ultimate consequence isn't required. It's just that someone else has already paid it for you. You see, when Jesus died upon the cross, he received the consequences of our sin. In John 19, we read the story of the death of Jesus Christ, and at the end, when Jesus died, he cried out from the cross, "It is finished." At least that's how we translate it in most of our Bibles today. But "it is finished" is not the most accurate translation. In the original text, the word "finished" is a commercial word that means it is paid. Paid in full. When Jesus died upon the cross, he paid our debt in full and thus set us free from the ultimate consequence of our sin. Now, please don't misunderstand me. There are still consequences for our sin. When we sin, there are going to be temporal consequences. That is the nature of life. You cannot set something into motion and expect that there will be no repercussions from it. But when Jesus sets us free, he frees us from the ultimate consequence. We do not have to pay God for our sins, because we are made right with him. Eternal death and eternal separation from God are consequences that we will not have to face if Jesus has set us free. In Jesus Christ, we have freedom. Freedom from guilt. Our past cannot haunt us. We are also free from the ultimate consequence of our sinful lives. Christ has paid our debt. And then third is freedom from accusation. We no longer have to live in fear. Colossians 1 says, "But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight without blemish and free from accusation." How nice is it not to have to run and hide? How nice is it not to have to worry that someone will find something out about you? How great would it be to be free from accusations and fear that your sins are going to be discovered? That would certainly be a freeing experience, would it not? There's a reason that Jesus sets us free from accusation. It's because when we surrender to Jesus and let him have control of our lives, he makes us blameless, and that's the key word here, blameless. Because of what Jesus did for us upon the cross, we are blameless before God when we know his son Jesus. The word blameless means free from guilt, not subject to blame anymore. As I said just a moment ago, Jesus took care of the eternal consequences of our sin, but Jesus did more than that. He also took care of our guilt. He satisfied the requirements of the law. When the law is broken, a death was required, and Jesus paid that penalty for us. Therefore, not on our own, but through Christ, we are found free of guilt and not subject to blame. Thus, we are free from accusation. And when a person is free from accusation, that person is free from a great deal of the fear that this life offers. We can stand before God and our brothers and sisters and not fear accusation. Now, being free of accusation does not mean that there will be no accusations that will come. We will certainly face accusations of all sorts in this life, and many of them, to be honest, are well deserved because of what we've done in our past. People have seen our sins and our mistakes, and they want to know why we now claim to be different. And that shouldn't threaten us. It should be an opportunity to share with them the transformation that Jesus brings to our lives. But now we need not fear accusation. We are now free from guilt. We are no longer subject to blame. The account has been laid to rest, and we can live without fear of a hidden past being brought to light, because it has already been brought to light and dealt with. Now, I can best illustrate this concept with a story about a little boy named Billy. Billy's grandfather had a slingshot, and one day he asked his grandfather if he would teach him how to shoot the slingshot. So his grandfather took him into the woods and began to teach the boy, and the grandfather told Billy to go and practice for a while. Well, Billy was in the woods alone, and he kept missing everything he shot at. On his way back to the house, Billy saw his grandfather's duck and decided to try his aim with the slingshot once more. Billy took aim and shot at the duck and hit his mark. The duck fell over dead. Billy took the duck and he buried it in the ground, and as he looked up, he saw his sister Sally standing there watching him, attempting to hide his deeds. Sally and Billy went back to their grandfather's house, and as they did so, Billy told Sally not to say anything. Sally said, "Sure, no problem." Well, the kid's grandfather told Sally to go into the kitchen to help her grandmother with the dishes, and Sally said, "Billy is the best dishwasher in the family. He would love to wash the dishes, wouldn't you, Billy?" And so Billy washed the dishes that night. And the next day, Billy's grandfather said, "Billy, let's go fishing today. Sally, your grandmother needs your help around the house, so stay here and help her out." Sally responded, "Billy hates fishing, but loves housework. Isn't that right, Billy?" And Billy stayed at home that day while Sally went fishing. And this went on for several days. Sally blackmailed Billy into every unpleasant chore around the farm and out of every enjoyable opportunity. And finally, Billy had had enough, and he decided to confess his crime. Much to his surprise, his grandfather said, "I knew you killed the duck. I saw you through the window. I also saw your sister standing there watching you. I forgave you when it happened because I love you. I just wanted to see how long you would let your sister make you her slave." When we don't turn to Jesus and confess our sins and allow him to cleanse us, we are slaves to our past and to our guilt, and we are susceptible to accusation. But once we come clean, we are free from accusation. We are no longer a slave. We are free from guilt, free from the ultimate consequence of our sinful lives, and free from accusation. Tomorrow, we celebrate the freedom of our nation. But I came to tell you today that there is a greater freedom than any political freedom. There is a freedom that we can have in Jesus Christ if we will place our trust in him. Jesus bled and died. He gave his life so that you and I could be free. If you've not accepted his sacrifice and the freedom it brings, would you accept it today? Before we move to our celebration of Holy Communion, would you bow with me in prayer for a moment? God, as we pause now before we move to the celebration of the Lord's Supper, we do so in order to take an opportunity to come clean. We don't want to be like Billy, being a slave to our past. We want to be set free from guilt, from eternal consequences, and from accusation, knowing that if the Son sets us free, we are free indeed. So transparently, we come before you, not on our own merit, but trusting in Jesus to make us worthy. And we thank you for that in his precious and holy name. Amen. In your bulletin, there is another little half sheet. It's a little liturgy to guide us through the celebration of Holy Communion this morning. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through the prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. Jesus healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread and gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we are one body. When we share the bread of Christ, is it not a sharing in the body of Christ? And likewise, when we give thanks over the cup, is it not a sharing in the blood of Christ? The body and blood of Christ given for me. As those that are assisting make their way forward, let me just share with you that we'll be receiving communion by the method of intinction. What that means is one of the servers will break a piece of bread off for you. And then you take the bread and dip it into the cup and receive both elements in that manner. Now, in the United Methodist Church, we practice something called open communion. And it's kind of what it sounds like. It means that communion is open to everyone. Children, youth, adults. You don't have to be a United Methodist. You don't have to be a member of Duck Church. Everyone is welcome to come who wants to experience the transforming freedom found in Jesus Christ our Lord. We'll have two stations up front, and the ushers will direct you in a moment. The choir will come down first, and you receive communion and then return to your seat by the side aisle. Body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. Amen. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. bottom of your liturgy sheet, there is a unison prayer that I will invite you to pray with me. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Well, friends, we are now going to receive the morning offering. So I'd like everyone, if you will, to consider what your next step will be this week. And let me just say to you that as you celebrate freedom tomorrow, remember that your greatest freedom is found in Jesus Christ. Also, I don't know where you are in your Bible reading right now, but I would like to invite and challenge everyone to commit to reading one chapter of the book of Genesis each day. If you're with us for the first time today, we're so glad that you're here, and we've got a little gift for you. It's a little book called How Good Is Good Enough, and it's all about how to know for certain that you'll go to heaven one day. We want you to be certain about that. So we would love it if you would pick one up. So all you need to do is drop your completed connection card in the offering plate, and then when you leave today, there's a table in the back wall on the right side that has many copies of the book. Please take one home. It's our way of saying thank you for worshiping with us. Well, God invites us to live in gratitude by offering what God has already given to us. Let's worship him now. Fathers, we walk in the freedom whereby Christ has set us free. Help us as we offer these gifts of gratitude to use them in ways that help others to find the same freedom that we enjoy. To the glory of your holy name we pray. Amen. Friends, let's remain standing and join in singing our closing hymn. It's found on page 117, O God, our help in ages past. Friends, if you're in town next weekend, be sure to come back next Sunday as we kick off a brand new series of messages on the book of Genesis, hence why I'm asking you to read a chapter each day. Next week, we're going to begin by focusing our attention on the first chapter of the book of Genesis through the second chapter, verse 4. And we're going to be talking about putting the creation story in its proper context. The message next week will be, "This is my Father's world." I hope that you'll be here, and I hope you'll invite a friend to worship with you. And now let's receive this blessing. May God be your refuge and strength. May Jesus Christ be your firm foundation. And may the Holy Spirit be your power and your salvation, so that everything you say and do proclaims the good news of the gospel. To the glory of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.